When I'm starting talks like this, I usually do a whole spiel about sustainability because a lot of people out there don't know what that is. This is a crowd that does know what it is, so I'll just do like the 60-second crib note version, right? So just bear with me, we'll go real fast, you know, fill in the blanks. So, sustainability, small planet, right? Pictured little Earth circling around the sun. You know, about 1 million years ago, a bunch of monkeys fell out of trees, got a little clever, harnessed fire, invented the printing press, made, you know, luggage with wheels on it, and, you know, built the society that we now live in. Unfortunately, while this society is without a doubt the most prosperous and dynamic the world has ever created, it's got some major, major flaws. One of them is that every society has an ecological footprint. It has an amount of impact on the planet that's measurable. How much stuff goes through your life? How much waste is left behind you? And we, at the moment, in our society, have a really dramatically unsustainable level of this. We're using up about 5 planets. If everybody on the planet lived the way we did, we'd need between 5, 6, 7, some people even say 10 planets to make it. Clearly, we don't have 10 planets. Again, you know, mental, visual, 10 planets, 1 planet, 10 planets, 1 planet, right? We don't have that. So that's one problem. The second problem is that the planet that we have is being used in wildly unfair ways, right? North Americans, such as myself, you know, we're basically sort of wallowing gluttonous hogs and we're eating all sorts of stuff. And, you know, then you get all the way down to people who live in the Asia Pacific region or even more Africa, and people simply do not have enough to survive. This is producing all sorts of tensions, all sorts of dynamics that are deeply disturbing, and there's more and more people on the way, right? So this is what the planet's going to look like in 20 years. It's going to be a pretty crowded place, at least 8 billion people. So, make matters even more difficult, it's a very young planet. A third of the people on this planet are kids. And those kids are growing up in a completely different way than their parents did, no matter where they live. They've been exposed to this idea of our society, of our prosperity. And they may not want to live exactly like us. They may not want to be Americans or Brits or Germans or South Africans, but they want their own version of a life which is more prosperous and more dynamic and more, you know, enjoyable. And all of these things combine to create an enormous amount of torque on the planet. And if we cannot figure out a way to deal with that torque, we are going to find ourselves more and more and more quickly facing situations which are simply unthinkable. Everybody in this room has heard the worst case scenarios. I don't need to go into that. I will ask the question, what's the alternative? And I would say that at the moment, the alternative is unimaginable. You know, so on the one hand, we have the unthinkable. On the other hand, we have the unimaginable. We don't know yet how to build a society which is environmentally sustainable, which is shareable with everybody on the planet, which promotes stability and democracy and human rights, and which is achievable in a time frame necessary to make it through the challenges we face. We don't know how to do this yet. So what's world changing? Well, world changing, you might think of as being a bit of a news service for the unimaginable future. You know, what we're out there doing is looking for examples of tools, models, and ideas which, if widely adopted, would change the game, right? A lot of times when I do a talk like this, I talk about things that everybody in this room, I'm sure, has already heard of, right? But most people haven't. So I thought today I'd do something a little different and talk about what we're looking for, rather than saying, you know, rather than giving you tried and true examples, talk about the kinds of things we're scoping out, give you a little peek into our editorial notebook. And given that I have 13 minutes to do this, this is going to go kind of quick, so I don't know, just stick with me, right? So first of all, what are we looking for? Bright green city. One of the biggest levers that we have in the developed world for changing the impact that we have on the planet is changing the way that we live in cities. We're already an urban planet. That's especially true in the developed world. And people who live in cities in the developed world tend to be very prosperous and thus use a lot of stuff. If we can change the dynamic by, first of all, creating cities that are denser and more livable, here, for example, is Vancouver, which if you haven't been there, you ought to go for a visit. It's a fabulous city. And they are doing density, new density, better than probably anybody else on the planet right now. They're actually managing to talk North America out of driving cars, which is a pretty great thing. So you have density, you also have growth management. you leave aside what is natural to be natural. This is in Portland. That is an actual development. That land there will remain pasture in perpetuity. They've bounded the city with a line, nature, city, nothing changes. Once you do those things, you can start making all sorts of investments. You can start doing things like transit systems that actually work to transport people in effective and reasonably comfortable manners, right? You can also start to change what you build. This is the Beddington Zero Energy Development in London, which is one of the greenest buildings in the world. It's a fabulous place. We're able to now build buildings that generate all their own electricity, that recycle much of their water, that are much more comfortable than standard buildings, use all natural light, et cetera, and over time, cost less. Green roofs. Bill McDonough covered that last night, so I won't dwell on that too much. But once you also have people living in close proximity to each other, one of the things that you can do is, as information technologies develop, you can start to have smart places. You can start to know where things are. When you know where things are, it becomes easier to share them. When you share them, you end up using less. So one great example is car share clubs, which are really starting to take off in the US, have already taken off in many places in Europe, and are a great example. If you're somebody who drives one day a week, do you really need your own car? Another thing that information technology lets us do is start figuring out how to use less stuff by knowing and by monitoring the amount we're actually using. So here's a power cord which glows brighter the more energy that you use, which I think is a pretty cool concept, although I think it ought to work the other way around, that it gets brighter the more you don't use. But there may even be a simpler approach. We could just relabel things. This light switch that reads on the one hand flash floods and on the other hand off. How we build things can change as well. This is a biomorphic building. It takes its inspiration in form from life. Many of these buildings are incredibly beautiful and also much more effective. This is an example of biomimicry, which is something we're really starting to look at a lot more for. In this case, you have a shell design, which was used to create a new kind of exhaust fan, which is greatly more effective. There's a lot of this stuff happening. It's really pretty remarkable. I encourage you to look on World Changing if you're into it. We're starting to cover this more and more. There's also neobiological design, where more and more we are actually using life itself and the processes of life to become part of our industry. So this, for example, is hydrogen-generating algae. So we have a model in potential, an emerging model that we're looking for of how to take the cities most of us live in and turn them into bright green cities. But unfortunately, most of the people on the planet don't live in the cities we live in. They live in the emerging megacities of the developing world. And there's a statistic I often like to use, which is that we're adding a city of Seattle every 4 days, a city the size of Seattle, to the planet every 4 days. I was giving a talk about 2 months ago, and this guy who'd done some work with the UN came up to me and was really flustered, and he said, look, you've got that totally wrong. It's totally wrong. It's every 7 days. So we're adding a city the size of Seattle every 7 days, and most of those cities look more like this than the city that you or I live in. Most of those cities are growing incredibly quickly. They don't have existing infrastructure. They have enormous numbers of people who are struggling with poverty and enormous numbers of people who are trying to figure out how to do things in new ways, right? So what do we need in order to make developing nation megacities into bright green megacities? Well, the first thing we need is we need leapfrogging. And this is one of the things that we are looking for everywhere. The idea behind leapfrogging is that if you are a person or a country who is stuck in a situation where you don't have the tools and technologies that you need, there's no reason for you to invest in last generation's technologies, right? That you're much better off, almost universally, looking for a low-